All right, this is the Elvin Jones interview, Newport Jazz, before it happens. Elvin, you played at Newport in the past. Tell us about the festival and what it means to the jazz world. What does Newport Jazz mean to the jazz world?
Well, it's one of the most significant forums, the Newport Jazz Festival, that is the most, I think, the most significant forum for the expression of our American art form. And it's as simple as that. And it's important because it brings people together. It's a friendly gathering for people to exchange ideas, to listen to the things that have developed here and that are developing, and with the artists involved. And everyone has it's a picnic, it's a holiday, it's a great time, it's a wonderful atmosphere.
Elvin, you rocketed to international fame during your years with John Coltrane. The music of the quartet is still influencing young jazz musicians all over the world. Tell us a little bit about Train and your creation and why they were so important.
Well, the years that I was with John Coltrane, it's very special. It's something very. First of all, it was an opportunity, certainly for me and for the rest of the members of the quartet to articulate all of our accumulated knowledge up to that point, and to have a way of expressing it and making it a cohesive sound within that context, and in a few words, I suppose it gave us an opportunity to play our music the way we felt about it, the way our was moved spiritually, emotionally, intellectually, in that fashion.
Just a little louder.
Yeah.
Who influenced you the most when you were a young man in your career? Who were your inspirations?
Well, my mother and father, of course, inspired me tremendously. They were always supportive and helpful and encouraging. And the band teacher in junior high school, Mr. Fred Wiest, he was a tremendous influence on me because, first of all, he was a master drummer. He graduated from the University of Michigan. He was the band leader, the drum major of the University of Michigan marching band during the time that Tom Harmon was a big football star there. And so I had tremendous respect for him, and he gave me the insight into study that I needed at that point in time, at that point in my life.
Elvin, you are widely acknowledged as the father of polyrhythmic jazz drumming. Tell us about your style and the barriers that you broke with it. I mean, you were the first.
I'm not so sure. Maybe polyrhythm is sort of a catch-22 phrase, you know. First of all, the rhythm in itself is simply a combination of different rhythmic patterns, and applied simultaneously to a drum set or to in any context, creates the kind of, sort of like listening to Dixieland jazz band, and you hear all of the instrumentalists are playing. They're all playing the same tune, but in different. They're all playing their own separate solo. Well, I suppose that more or less explains or articulates what polyrhythms are more than anything else.
Elvin, you spent a great deal of time in Japan. One famous Japanese love of jazz. Japanese just adore the music. How do you explain that?
Well, I suppose the Japanese could explain it better than I can, but I think they just—it simply recognized, as many people do. I'm sure there are just as many people in the United States that recognize it and appreciate it as there are Japanese people, but they are more—they have a. More, everything is an organization, and so they appreciate it in a form of organized appreciation, which is a little bit different than what we do. But I think they see in it the essence of American culture and development, and they can try to emulate and they certainly appreciate that. That aspect of our culture.
Elvin, there's a great deal of controversy about the electronic influence in the jazz. Mm. Jazz is a medium that comes from your heart and your soul, not from an electronic chip. Yeah. Any thoughts on that?
Well, I'm a dyed-in-the-wool acoustic man, and so I like acoustical instruments. I like. I'm sure that the electronics have some values. Obviously, they do. But to me, I haven't heard very many artists that know enough about electronics to make it a significant thing, other than just. Creating more and more decibels. I mean, it's very easy to overpower a violinist that's simply playing without a pickup on his instrument with an electric guitar, for instance. But you still have to play the instrument itself. I think you can't get around that basic fact. The instrument has to be articulated, has to be played with the emotion. Now, if you can translate that emotion into an electronic chip, as they say, well, then I think it would be fine. And until we learn how to do that, I think it's still going to be a sort of an experiment.
One more question, if I may. Do you remember when you first, how young were you when you first started? And do you remember your first couple of gigs? Where did you start?
Yeah. Well, I was about 12 years old, and I played a drum solo with my brother Hank. He was playing, accompanying me on the piano in a church recital in our church in Pontiac, Michigan. So that was really my first gig.
Was that your first professional gig?
Well, I wasn't professional, actually. I was still an amateur at that time, but later on, I didn't really turn professional until after I was out of the Air Corps and into the... I was 22 years old before I turned actually professional.
Elvin, who are your heroes in the business today? Who do you revere, who you feel is great?
Well, I think Wynton Marsalis is one of the greatest musicians to come along in a many, many years. And I think the real significance of his contribution has yet to be seen. He's a tremendous artist, he's a tremendous intellect, he's a tremendous energy that he displays at all times, and he's a gentleman, he's articulate, and he's a master of his of what he's doing.
Okay, thank you very much, Elvin.
Yes.
Thank you.